This is Eyewitness News on LA 56 with live breaking news.
Breaking news, a teenager shot in the head as she's getting out of a car in Palmdale. We have an update on her condition and the search for a gunman.
A vigil is underway as a woman accused of being behind the wheel in a deadly church crash faces a judge from a gurney.
And President Obama criticizes Sony Pictures for giving in to North Korea. But Sony is now firing back, and now even Larry Flint is sounding off. Good evening, I'm Colleen Sullivan.
I'm Mark Brown, in for David Ono. Welcome to Eyewitness News on LA 56, LA's only live local newscast at 7 p.m. There is breaking news. A teenage girl in extremely critical condition after being shot in the head in Palmdale. The LA County Sheriff's Department says it happened about noon today near Melton Avenue and Avenue R. Investigators say this was a drive-by shooting. The victim has no known or suspected gang affiliation. Detectives have found what they think is the suspect's vehicle, and they've detained three people. We'll bring you a live report from the scene ahead on Eyewitness News at 7:30.
A community continues to mourn after a deadly crash outside a church that left four people, including a six-year-old boy, dead. This as the woman charged in that crash appeared in court on a gurney. Eyewitness News reporter Melissa McBride is live in Redondo Beach, where a vigil is underway. Melissa?
And Colleen, that vigil tonight is a private vigil, but people are still coming here to the memorial and leaving flowers at the intersection of PCH and Vincent. Today, the church community of St. James Catholic Church learned that six-year-old Samuel Gaza died last night of his injuries. The kindergartner and his family were in the crosswalk on Wednesday night crossing PCH when they were hit by a car that ran the red light. His mother, Martha, was killed. Samuel's father and two sisters were injured. Two elderly women also died, Mary Wilson and Saiko Matsumura. 56-year-old Margot Bronstein pleaded not guilty today in Torrance to four counts of vehicular manslaughter while intoxicated and driving under the influence of a drug causing injury. She was on a gurney because of her injuries from the accident. Police say Bronstein ran the red light at PCH and Vincent as people were leaving St. James Catholic Church and crossing the street. Her attorney says it's unknown if Bronstein had an adverse reaction to medication or if her car with hand-controlled brakes may have malfunctioned.
It appears that everybody's jumping to conclusions about this case. We have no toxicology level. We have no blood alcohol level. We know that Ms. Bronstein is an individual who does not live her life recklessly. Obviously, she feels terrible. This is nothing more than an accident.
Thank you for supporting me.
And today we heard from accident survivor 13-year-old Jasper Lem. He thanked everyone for their prayers. His father posted this video from his hospital room on Facebook. Lem had surgery on his broken shoulder today. Now, if Bronstein is convicted as charged, she faces up to 40 years in prison. Reporting live in Redondo Beach, I'm Melissa McBride, ABC 7 Eyewitness News.
Melissa, thank you. Police are searching for the person who caused a big crash in Sun Valley. Just after 1 this morning, a pickup truck lost control, crashed into a fire hydrant, and took down two power poles, snapping them in half. It happened in the 8100 block of Lancashire Boulevard, and you can see water shooting about 100 feet into the air from that busted hydrant. The driver of the truck ran off, and police are still working to track that person down. The power was out to about 1,100 customers in the area, but it has since been restored.
The President of the United States takes on Sony Pictures, blasting the movie studio for its decision to pull a movie. Tonight, Sony Pictures CEO fires off his own response. Eyewitness News reporter Carlos Grande joins us with more on a battle that's rocking Hollywood and the nation's capital and eliciting a response from none other than Larry Flint.
Well, that's right. The FBI confirms North Korea is behind the cyber attack against Sony. President Obama says dictators cannot start imposing censorship in the United States. And the CEO of Sony says it had no choice but to cancel the movie's release since theaters were refusing to show it.
I think they made a mistake.
President Obama says Sony should have come to him before pulling its movie, The Interview. The president says this could set a bad precedent where dictators from other countries threaten us because they're offended over documentaries or news reports in the U.S.
Or even worse, imagine if producers and distributors and others start engaging in self-censorship because they don't want to offend the sensibilities of somebody whose sensibilities probably need to be offended.
Sony Entertainment CEO Michael Lynton disagrees with the president. He says Sony did not cave or back down.
The movie theaters came to us one by one over the course of a very short period of time, we were completely surprised by it, and announced that they would not carry the movie. At that point in time, we had no alternative but to not proceed with the theatrical release on the 25th of December.
Hustler magazine publisher Larry Flint is a staunch defender of free speech. He plans to release his own parody of The Interview, and he says this action is making us look weak around the world.
It makes us look like we're buffoon, you know? I mean, nobody can collectively seem to get their act together. Of course it makes us look vulnerable and weak to other countries who are looking to exploit us.
The president says the U.S. will act against North Korea.
They caused a lot of damage, and we will respond. We will respond proportionally, and we'll respond in a place and time and manner that we choose.
And there's a new message by the hacker sent to executives at Sony saying it was a, quote, very wise decision to cancel the movie's release and that they don't want it released in any form. I'm Carlos Grande, ABC 7 Eyewitness News. Mark, back to you.
All right, Carlos, thank you. Investigators need your help to track down additional suspects involved in one of the largest art thefts in L.A. history. The art was stolen 6 years ago. It's reportedly worth about $10 million collectively. Recently, investigators were able to recover 9 out of the 12 paintings in an undercover operation. Police arrested 45-year-old Raul Espinosa, who allegedly tried to sell the artwork. Now they're offering a $25,000 reward in hopes of flushing out more suspects.
The FBI and LAPD will not give up on any investigation until we have been able to recover the artifacts and bring the people responsible to justice.
Espinosa has been charged with one count of receiving stolen property. He's pleaded not guilty and is currently being held on $5 million bail.
Exclusive video tonight revealing what happened immediately after football star Ray Rice assaulted his now wife in a New Jersey elevator. The surveillance video exclusively obtained by ABC News shows a distraught Janae Palmer handcuffed in an elevator alongside Rice. That's him with a blue hood on. The two then appear to kiss each other before being escorted to separate police cars. Rice has been cleared to play in the NFL, but so far no teams have signed him.
A lot of holiday travelers hitting the road tonight. It's the Friday before Christmas, generally the beginning of the busy travel rush. Here's a live picture of the El Toro Y from our camera in Irvine. Lots of cars out there, but they do appear to be moving pretty well. This year, AAA predicts more people will be hitting the road than any holiday season since 2001, nearly 8 million of us. And at LAX, they consider tonight the beginning of the travel season. Between now and January 2nd, about 3 million people will pass through the airport. That's 4% more than a year ago.
And to find out how our weekend is looking and how our weather's shaping up for the holiday weekend, let's go to meteorologist Jonathan Novak. Jonathan.
We get spring in the forecast, guys. Santa's hopefully going to bring us some cooler weather for Christmas, but we've got some warm temperatures to look forward to in the meantime. Today was relatively cool, a little below average for the temps, and that Malibu time-lapse, fantastic. We had some clouds that moved in with a front to the north. That's where we're seeing this rain associated with the front develop up to the northern portions of California. Now, this is not going to make it into our area. We're looking for a dry Friday night into Saturday, but looking for a cool one. Temperatures are currently in the 50s in L.A., 58, 59 Santa Monica, 57 Oxnard and Van Nuys. And I'll step out of the way. Here you go, Palm Springs, 61 for you. Tomorrow morning, below right about average, actually, for the morning lows, 51, but below average for the afternoon highs just by a bit. And then things will really change. We are going to warm up. It looks like temperatures hitting the 80s somewhere in that forecast to tell you when and what it's looking like for Christmas Day, too, coming up in a few minutes.
All right, Jonathan, we'll see you in a few minutes.
Well, it's a holiday tradition that could get a little stressful, shopping at the last minute. That's what a lot of people are doing on this last weekend before Christmas. At Northridge Fashion Center, retailers are putting up the numbers they want to see, 40, 50, and even more than 70% off. Shoppers we spoke with say they prefer hands-on shopping to buying gifts online.
Still not that crazy about online. You know, I like to see, feel, you know, what you're buying, especially if you give people special, you know.
Analysts say Super Saturday could generate about $10 billion in sales nationwide, surpassing Black Friday. Several big retailers are extending their hours. Kohl's department stores will be open 24 hours a day until Christmas Eve. Macy's is open from 7 till midnight every day until Christmas Eve.
The holiday shopping season is in full swing, and so is the shoplifting season. Many stores are outfitting their most vulnerable areas with cameras, hoping to deter shoplifters. And outside in shopping mall parking lots, you could become a victim of the holiday thieves as well.
This time of year puts a lot of financial stress on people, and you know, more people tend to go out there and shoplift. Word gets around that the cameras are watching, and then people are less likely to commit those crimes.
We have seen people who are walking and casing through parking lots, looking into cars. So we definitely need everybody to lock their doors and put their items in the trunk.
And some more good advice for holiday shoppers. Always be aware of your surroundings.
Up next, Olympic champion Michael Phelps speaks out after entering a plea in court.
Also tonight, a Grinch swipes a wheelchair from a four-year-old girl, the desperate plea to get it back.
And a dye job wasn't enough to hide this stolen dog's true identity. How animal services determined her real color.
And despite repeated efforts to save it, demolition underway on a century-old home in Los Feliz.
There is outrage today from the family of a young girl whose custom wheelchair was stolen less than a week before Christmas. The specialized wheelchair, which costs about $2,000, was stolen from the family's front porch earlier this week.
But now the community is coming together to get her a new one. Inland Empire Bureau Chief Rob McMillan has more, including how the family is reacting.
I'm angry that somebody would come and take something from her. And who does this? Who does this?
Alex Flores says her four-year-old sister, Jocelyn, who has Down syndrome, needs this wheelchair to get around the house and to go to school. But it was stolen the other night, right off the front porch of their Corona home.
Pues me siento muy triste.
Jocelyn's mother says she's sad and disappointed that someone would do this. The chair is expensive, around $2,500.
We just want a chair for Jocelyn. That's all we're working on right now. If we can't find that one, then that's why we're working on trying to get her a second chair.
When we first got here, this was a story about a Grinch. But since our arrival, it's now become a story of giving.
My brother, he works for the medical supply.
It started with offers from neighbors, and now at least one group has offered to give Jocelyn a chair for free.
It's overwhelming, to be honest. I mean, yesterday and this morning we were still struggling, thinking, oh, how are we going to get Jocelyn a chair? Jocelyn. Now all of a sudden we're getting all these calls.
Pues me voy a sentir agradecida.
Jocelyn's mother says she's grateful and very happy that Jocelyn might finally have a chair so she can move around again. Thanks to the generosity of the community, she should have that new chair in time for Christmas.
It's very nice. I'm grateful. It's beyond words.
In Corona, Rob McMillan, ABC 7 Eyewitness News.
And new video is released of Michael Phelps' drunk driving arrest in Baltimore. The Maryland Transportation Authority has released surveillance video showing the 29-year-old Olympic swimmer's arrest in September. Phelps was leaving a casino when he was pulled over for speeding and crossing a double yellow line while driving in a tunnel. Police say Phelps registered a 1.4 on a blood alcohol test. And today, Phelps at police.
I'm happy to be moving forward, and you know, I'll continue to grow from this and continue on my path of recovery.
Phelps entered a treatment program in October. This is his second DUI conviction.
Someone went to great lengths to apparently kidnap and disguise a dog. That person dyed the dog black to try to hide her. This is Coco with her natural coat of fur. According to Coco's owner, she believes someone stole the dog from her yard over the Thanksgiving week. Coco must have escaped because she ended up at the San Jacinto Valley Animal Campus looking a little bit different, as you see here. Luckily, the 8-month-old pit bull was microchipped and reunited with her owner. It's still not clear who gave Coco that bad dye job.
No kidding. Hopefully it'll grow out soon. Yeah.
Chip your dog.
No
That's great
kidding.
Evidence right there. It works.
Exactly.
It helps when the situation is, makes sense to you. So.
Exactly.
Okay, let's talk about the weather. Because
yeah.
You know what? 80s in the forecast, does that make you... Does it make you smile, or is it sort of
amazing.
Like, okay, I don't mind it. I just like to call home and just say, hey, it's Christmas almost, and it's 80 degrees in Southern California. Yeah, it's kind of fun. Hey, Mark, you saw this earlier today. How about this for a time lapse? Colleen, have you seen this yet?
Beautiful.
No.
This is one of the best time lapses I think we've had in a long time. I don't know the last time something like this. The colors with the low clouds, some of the in the Angeles National Forest, by the way, and some of the high cloud cover, just making some amazing images here for our time lapses today, and this is probably, I think, the best one. Yeah, it could be. Yeah. Live Megadolphin 7000 HD. That's because ahead of the cold front to the north, we've got this cloud cover that's rolled in, but we're not going to see the rain move in, and that's, in fact, fizzling out to the north of us right now. Fresno, some light to moderate rainfall around there to the San Francisco area. For us, so far in December, we've had well above average rainfall, 3.69 in downtown L.A., Burbank, about 3 1/3 or so, over 4 inches in Camarillo, Santa Barbara, and Long Beach, all 3 to 4 inches above the normal where we normally would be for this time of year for December. Now, you look at where the drought is now. As a result, we're still well below where we need to be. This is where we were last week, an exceptional drought. 55% of the state was there. Now, 32% of the state is in an exceptional drought. That's the worst you can get. So we've had a bit of an improvement, but we've got a long ways to go. Okay, so we're not looking for any rain in the forecast, unfortunately or fortunately, you might say, but we're looking for temperatures to really start warming up. Right now, we're in the 50s in L.A., and we're looking for overnight lows to be in the lower 50s, a little bit above average, maybe by a degree or two. Here's the front that we were just looking at. That's going to fizzle out north of our area, and then we'll start seeing high pressure build in, and that means warmer weather is ahead. Saturday afternoon into Sunday, we'll see those winds change to the northeast. Right there, you see those wind directions right there, the northeast, and Sunday into Monday. That means a Santa Ana wind. That means breezy conditions and much warmer weather. In fact, I said 80s. Yeah, Tuesday afternoon, we should hit 80 in L.A. Until then, tomorrow, 66 in L.A., 66 Glendale. The Antelope Valley, around 58 degrees, and the IE, around 64, give or take, and 66 in Oceanside. Here's that 7-day forecast, L.A. Metro and Orange County, powered up by AccuWeather. So tomorrow, about what you saw today in terms of the temperatures and the cloud cover, and then Sunday, sunnier, 71, 77 on Monday, breezy and much warmer on Tuesday, 80 degrees, and Santa, 68. We're going to cool back down just in time for Christmas Day. 68 is about where we should be anyway for this time of year. Valley's IE, you got temperatures in the 60s tomorrow, but then into the 70s on Sunday, and you're at 80 on Tuesday. We'll cool it back down a little bit on Wednesday, and then back to average on Thursday, just in time again for Santa, and then a few clouds in the beach areas for tomorrow. In fact, we have high surf for Saturday and Sunday. It looks like 6 to 8 feet for west-facing beaches for Saturday and Sunday. If you do head out to the beaches, watch out for that. And then mountains, 45 tomorrow, partly cloudy, breezy from Sunday through Tuesday. Temperatures getting near 60 by Tuesday. And then the high desert, 58 tomorrow. And you're in the 60s for just about the rest of the forecast. Sunny skies for the most part, and Santa is happy about somewhat cooler weather as we head right into Christmas Day.
Okay. Thank you very much, Jonathan. Yeah. Well, the fight is over. It's been a long battle for preservation, but the Oswald Bartlett House in Los Feliz is finally coming down. Eyewitness News reporter Leo Stallworth spoke to neighbors who say they're sad to see the old house go.
Despite pleas from preservationists to save the century-old Los Feliz home, a demolition crew used heavy equipment to bring it down this afternoon. This video, given to us by a local resident, shows the demolition. We talked to outraged residents.
It's criminal. This is our history. It's Hollywood history. You see history torn down before you. Plus, there was beautiful things in there that they didn't even bother to salvage.
The home was designed by famed architect A.C. Martin, who also designed L.A. City Hall. Downtown Hall of Justice, the old May Company building. The city could have spared the historic home the wrecking ball had it deemed it a historic monument. That would have given it added protection against alteration and demolition.
We're a little heartbroken today. The battle to save this beautiful house is lost.
The home, known for its many design features, including a curve in the roof giving it the look of a raised eyebrow, is being replaced by a multi-unit townhouse complex by developer Elon Murdoch.
Well, Bill, there are those who would say this home sits in the middle of a sea of apartment buildings and it needed to come down, but you think otherwise.
Well, I think it's pretty simple. You have L.A. history here. This is a 100-year-old A.C. Martin house. The question is, if all the community supports it, if it's part of L.A. history, why isn't it worth saving?
Some sad residents say with the house turned to rubble, they have their memories of what was, folks. This is what was. And those hits, real stalwart, ABC 7.
Up next, why some major grocery chain stores will soon be sporting a new name.
Plus, which cell phone company will have to pay up to $90 million for billing customers for services they didn't order.
Then, caught on camera, a tire flies off a truck and smashes through a window into a man working in a business. We're going to show you how he's doing.
Some of the Vons, Pavilions, and Albertsons supermarkets here in Southern California will soon have a new owner and a new name. Hagen, that's a small grocery chain in the Northwest, is buying 146 stores throughout the West. This is because of the upcoming merger between Albertsons and Safeway. The Federal Trade Commission is requiring the two companies to sell off some of their stores.
T-Mobile will pay up to $90 million for billing customers for cell phone text services they didn't order. It's part of a new settlement with federal regulators. The Federal Trade Commission sued T-Mobile in July, accusing it of billing customers for subscriptions to text services like horoscopes or celebrity gossip updates that they didn't want or authorize. T-Mobile will now pay refunds of affected customers plus $22.5 million in fines. Staples says 1.2 million customer cards may have been compromised in a security breach. The company first announced the hacking in October, saying the cyber criminals had deployed malware at 115 of its stores. Staples said its investigation shows the criminals were able to access transaction data, including cardholder names, payment card numbers, expiration dates, and card verification codes. Staples is the latest in a string of data breaches at national retailers.
More positive news about California's economy. The Employment Development Department released its latest report showing the state added more than 90,000 new jobs in November. The unemployment rate dipped to 7.2%. That's down from its peak of 12.4% in February of 2010. California is still above the national unemployment rate of 5.8%.
We are updating the evening's top stories next here at 7:30.
Including the latest on a teenager shot in the head in Palmdale. We'll have the latest on her condition and the investigation.
Plus, what the autopsy on the mayor of Bell Gardens reveals, why family members think the mayor's wife should face charges.
This is Eyewitness News on LA 56 with live breaking news.
Breaking news at 7:30. A teenager has been shot in the head. Good evening. I'm Mark Brown in for David Ona.
And I'm Colleen Sullivan. This is Eyewitness News on LA 56, LA's only live local newscast at 7 p.m. The teenager is said to be in severely critical condition at this hour. Eyewitness News reporter Jory Rand is live at the scene with the breaking details. Jory?
Yeah, guys, the situation sounds very dire for this girl. She was shot in the back of the head in a drive-by shooting, taken to a local hospital where she underwent surgery, remains in extremely critical condition. The car she was getting out of remains here tonight, just as it was when it happened around noon this afternoon. The door of that Acura, a Navy Acura, remains open tonight. That is where the shooting happened, and police continue their investigation. Now, we have some video of the scene from earlier in the day. This happened around 12 noon. We are on Melton Avenue near Avenue R. The girl was just getting out of the car when another car drove by and opened fire. Sheriffs here believe it was a high caliber handgun that did the shooting, and it did quite some damage. There was another boy in the car. He was injured as well, but not shot. It was just shattered glass. He suffered minor injuries and was okay. Now, it is believed that the suspects are now in custody. Sheriffs say they have taken three people into custody. It's also believed that the car that was involved in this shooting was also recovered. Some witnesses who live on the street here saw sheriffs driving down the road about 4 miles. They hopped right behind the sheriffs and followed. They witnessed the pursuit and said about 4 miles away on Palmdale Boulevard and 10th Street West is where that went down, where that car also remains, another part of this crime scene. But the situation does seem dire for this teenage girl shot in the back of the head in a drive-by here in Palmdale. She remains in extremely critical condition. We will be here all evening long looking for the very latest information on this situation. But for now, we're live in Palmdale. Jory Rand, ABC 7 Eyewitness News.
Okay, Jory, thank you. The autopsy has been released on the Bell Gardens mayor who was shot and killed by his wife. His wife said it was self-defense and has not been arrested. But as Eyewitness News reporter Sid Garcia explains, the new autopsy report might change that.
And I have a feeling we're going to have an indictment or an arrest by Christmas.
That's the hope of Daniel Crespo's family and their lawyer. They say Crespo's wife, Livette Crespo, shot and killed the mayor of Bell Gardens in cold blood, not self-defense. They released part of the autopsy report, which quotes a police report alleging the late mayor of Bell Gardens was verbally and physically abusive to his wife for over 20 years. It also says the couple's daughter told investigators the night of the shooting her parents were not sleeping in the same bedroom and her father would drag her mother by the hair to force her to do so.
These accusations of rape and brutality are false. If there's anyone these children need to be afraid of, is their mother.
Crespo was shot and killed September 30th in his Bell Gardens home. Police say Crespo was arguing with the couple's 19-year-old son when his wife, Livette, shot him three times. Livette telling investigators it was self-defense.
When you get three shots in the chest like this, obviously she's not fighting with the son, because she's not going to take a chance of killing her son. So the father must have been away at that point, and bam, 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 three shots in the chest. That's murder to me.
Livette's attorney told me he had no comment on today's news conference.
A spokesperson for the DA's office tells me the case is still under investigation. She said, though, that a ruling could come right after the first of the year. In downtown L.A., Sid Garcia, ABC 7 Eyewitness News.
Another tragedy in Australia. A mother under arrest in the murders of eight children at a home in northern Australia. The 37-year-old is the mother of seven of the victims. The eighth has been identified as her niece. The children ranged in age from 18 months to 14 years. The woman is being treated for stab wounds to the chest. Police say several knives inside the house may have been used to kill the children. The tragedy comes just days after a gunman stormed an Australian cafe, killing two people in a day-long hostage ordeal.
Some victims of the Colorado Theater shooting are outraged. The parents of suspect James Holmes are pleading for him to be spared the death penalty. Robert and Arlene Holmes released a statement today saying their son is mentally ill and they don't want him to be executed. James Holmes has pleaded not guilty by reason of insanity to killing 12 people and injuring 70 others in the 2012 attack. His parents are asking for a plea deal that would put him in an institution for the rest of his life. They say, quote, "We love our son, we have always loved him, and we do not want him to be executed." They go on to say a lengthy trial requires everyone to relive those horrible moments in time, causing additional trauma, end quote.
President Barack Obama gave more details about a historic shift in the U.S.-Cuba relations. During his final news conference of the year today, the president said he and Cuban President Raul Castro each took turns joking about the other one being long-winded. The 45-minute phone call was the first conversation between the two nations in more than 50 years. On Wednesday, the president announced he is reopening the embassy and reestablishing diplomatic ties that were severed in 1961 when Fidel Castro took power.
If you've done the same thing for 50 years and nothing's changed, you should try something different.
President Obama says he imagines he'll visit Cuba at some point in his life, but he says it's not in the cards right now. During the news conference, President Obama made history. In the question and answer portion, the president only called on female reporters. The White House press secretary says they wanted to highlight the many women who work for news organizations to cover the president and the White House every day.
And our final Stuff a Bus event was a great success today.
You helped Garth the Elf set new records in Cerritos, Ontario, Canoga Park, and Anaheim.
Garth the Elf and his team were out at the Honda Center very early this morning collecting toys and donations for our Spark of Love campaign. We broke a record stuffing 27 buses full of toys. The toys will now be distributed to families in need throughout Southern California.
Students from Francis Polytechnic High School invaded the Mattel toy store in Pomona today, buying toys for underprivileged kids. The students raised more than $16,000 through a number of fundraising efforts since August. They say buying the toys is a highlight of their holiday season, and school leaders say it's become a great tradition.
This is our leadership class, and we do this. This is the 50th year we've done this.
Once purchased, the toys were given to members of the LA Fire Department. They'll then be distributed to families in the San Fernando Valley.
There are a lot of smiling faces in Santa Ana today as about 3,000 kids got a new toy. It was all part of the 20th annual Nancy's Miracle Toy Giveaway held at the UC Irvine Family Health Center. The kids who came out got a visit with Santa before getting a toy. Some were lucky enough to head home with a bike. In addition to the toys, the event also featured food giveaways and free health screenings.
A Christmas tradition is coming alive in downtown LA's Skid Row. Tomorrow, the Fred Jordan Mission will give away toys, food, and clothing to some 10,000 families. It's part of the mission's 70th annual Christmas toy party. Volunteers will be handing out the gifts and serving up a Christmas feast. The event also features Christmas carolers and a visit from Mickey and Minnie Mouse.
Local theaters get a little sequel crazy today with both The Hobbit and The Night at the Museum franchises moving into thousands of screens. The Hobbit, The Battle of the Five Armies, has been dominating the box office since it opened Wednesday. It will easily win the weekend, but the third museum film, Secret of the Tomb, will draw its own loyal fan base to see the end of that trilogy. And also new today, an updated version of the musical Annie is new to theaters this weekend. It's aimed at being a fun family entertainment event, but you can bet your bottom dollar on it. Our entertainment guru George Panocchio has a review.
This version of Annie takes place in a very modern world. Evangeline Wallace plays the title role, an upbeat foster kid who believes she's going to be reunited with her parents. Cameron Diaz is her not-so-caring foster mom, and Jamie Foxx, the equivalent of Daddy Warbucks, is the man who could change Annie's life, or perhaps vice versa. This Annie is probably best for girls around the age of the girls in the film. It plays to that crowd. So if you're no longer 10, it probably won't hold your interest all the way through. But for kids, their song and dance and silly stuff, they may love it. And you know you'll be hearing this in your house afterwards.
It's our knock.
Some of the songs in the film sound like they got some help from Auto-Tune. The stars seem to be having fun here, and I can appreciate that. Diaz does take it a little over the top at times, but she and Fox have their moments.
Look for me, Colleen Hannigan.
Like me on Facebook.
I don't like you in Harlem. Why would I like you on Facebook?
You think you're better than me?
I do think I'm better than you.
This movie's aim is purely to entertain, and if you're a kid, I think Annie succeeds in doing that. If you're an adult, well, you may want to consider some more grown-up options at the box office. George Panocchio, ABC 7 Eyewitness News.
Up next, an update on this year's flu making its way across the country.
And could a popular over-the-counter painkiller help you live longer? There's new information coming up.
Cool and cloudy, turning to sunny and really, really warm. Details ahead in the 7-day forecast. Big night.
pretty amazing video out of Houston, Texas. A man was hit by a runaway tire while working in a medical clinic. Watch here as a wheel comes crashing through the front window, slamming Manuel Mendoza to the ground. The 77-year-old janitor was cleaning the waiting room with his wife when the tire came flying out of nowhere. It was later found to have come from a truck traveling on a nearby freeway. Mendoza was taken to the hospital, treated for cuts and bruises. Thankfully, he suffered no major injuries.
Well, the latest information from the CDC shows that the flu is definitely starting to hit harder, and experts who track influenza show it's making its way across the U.S. For now, experts say we're still not in an epidemic, but the number of deaths from the flu has risen since last week. The country as a whole is experiencing elevated cases of influenza-like illness, with southern states being hit the hardest. Scientists report that H3 strains are most commonly found with adults 65 and older, most likely to be hospitalized. A common over-the-counter pain reliever many of us take for a headache or muscle ache might help you live longer. Scientists are growing more excited about the potential life-extending prospects of ibuprofen. Health specialist Denise DeDore takes a look.
For Mildred Ortiz, the pain reliever ibuprofen is a medicine cabinet staple.
For headaches, it does help me with the headaches.
Now, a new 3-year study shows this common pain reliever may help with more than headaches. Scientists at the Buck Institute for Research on Aging found regular doses may lead to a longer, healthier life.
We're very intrigued that a drug that people have been taking for decades might actually be affecting aging.
Dr. Brian Kennedy and his colleagues found treating baker's yeast, worms, and flies with ibuprofen added about 15% more to the species' lives. In humans, that would equal about a decade more of healthy living.
Aging is this process that enables disease. As you get older, you're more likely to get sick. And if you could slow down that aging process.
Researchers say what ibuprofen does is suppress the uptake of amino acids. Our bodies need these essential building blocks, but experts suggest many of us may be getting too much.
So if you cut down the levels of certain amino acids, it makes the organism live longer, and we think it might be a strategy similar to dietary restriction.
Slower protein synthesis equals slower aging. Mildred wants to do all she can to continue to live a long, healthy life.
I have to watch my diet as far as foods, you know, can't eat too much salt, and you have to diet exercise as well.
Dr. Kennedy says Mildred is on the right track, but it's too early to recommend people take ibuprofen if they don't need it. In the meantime, research shows life extenders include eating the Mediterranean way and doing resistance workouts. You could do these things right now to live healthy longer. Scientists are just looking for ways to improve upon it. Denise DeDore, ABC 7 Eyewitness News.
And Dr. Kennedy says the next step is to see if they get the same results in animals and humans.
Coming up, some big changes in our weather ahead. Meteorologist Jonathan Novak has the forecast up next.
Plus in sports, what do President Obama, Joe Flacco, and Sony's decision to pull a movie have in common? The answer ahead. An American speed skater is preparing for a 2,500-mile journey this summer when he will skate from Missouri to Oregon along the Lewis and Clark Trail. Today, Corey Schuyler Drouillard set out on a two-day skate of Death Valley Highway. It's ahead of a three-month trip he plans to begin in June called the Skate for George. He hopes it will draw attention to his ancestor George Drouillard, an important but largely forgotten member of the Lewis and Clark expedition.
All right, Jonathan Novak is here with your Friday forecast, my favorite forecast.
I was exhausted. That was exhausting watching him. I feel like I did my exercise for the day just watching that. Speaking of exercise, it's going to be great to get out, not just for tomorrow, but as we head into the next week. We're looking for temperatures to feel like spring. Can you believe it? We're heading into Christmas, and Santa's going to need his T-shirt and shorts. All right, outside right now. Do you think he's got that?
I don't know.
In storage? I think he's going to have to break him out of storage. All right. Well, I'm making it off with 7000 HD. Glad we covered that. So some showers up to the north around Fresno, but this is actually a front that's been fizzling out. So it's not going to bring us any rain. Okay, we're going to look for some additional cloud cover, which we had today, and tomorrow. And then things really change up. We're talking heat, really, for this time of year. Almanac today shows the lack of that. We actually were at 66 in downtown L.A., very close to the average of 67. That's our normal. 50 was our low, and our normal was 47, pretty seasonable today. Clouds were around, but no rain. 59 in Malibu at the moment, and around the area, that is kind of the story, upper 50s right now. 57 Van Nuys, Burbank, Oxnard, and you've got 30s, of course, in the mountains, 37 Wrightwood, 33 already, chilly 9 Big Bear, and 61 Palm Springs, 50. Good evening, Hemet, for you. A little cool right now. Okay, so this is a front up to the north of us, and it's fizzling out. In fact, you can see over the loop here on the satellite and radar imagery, the rain was heavier up in the northern portions of the state and really just died off into some light rain in the central portions of California now. So for tonight, that's going to fizzle, and we'll see the clouds stick around for tomorrow, but then things change as we get into late Saturday into Sunday. Watch the future scan, and you're going to notice this big arc here. That's a ridge of high pressure. It starts building in Saturday into Sunday. This is Sunday afternoon, Sunday night, and then we go into Monday, and this is a really strong ridge of high pressure. For this time of year, we're looking for temperatures to be way above average, 80 degrees. Can you believe that? By Tuesday afternoon. For tomorrow, though, more of the same. 66 in L.A., 65 in Northridge and Pasadena, 64 Ontario, and 64 down by the coast. 7-day forecast, L.A. Metro and Orange County, powered up by AccuWeather. Tomorrow's a lot like today. Maybe a little bit more sunshine in the afternoon as that high starts moving our way. 66 and then into Sunday, 71, 77 on Monday. And there you go, breezy and, I don't know, 80. It's warm. I don't know if it's hot, but it's certainly for this time of year, relatively speaking, that is hot. 80 degrees on Tuesday, 75 on Wednesday, and then Santa is going to bring some cooler weather on Thursday for Christmas Day. We're back to average, 68. All right, Valley's IE, 64 tomorrow, 72 on Sunday, and 77 breezy on Monday and Tuesday. We got those Santa Anas kicking in, 80 on Tuesday, and then we're down to 68 once again, just in time for Christmas morning. Beaches, well, you got a couple days where you're going to have to watch out for the high surf. We have 6 to 8 feet for the surf for the west-facing beaches for Saturday and Sunday. Otherwise, the temperatures are going to be in the 50s and 60s, and then the mountains are warming up to about 57 by Tuesday. The winds are going to be kicking in for Tuesday, and Christmas looks pretty good. And the high desert, you're in the 60s from Sunday on. That's your weather. Have a great night.
Okay, Jonathan, thanks a lot. Well, it's not how you start, it's how you finish. It's true in hockey, too. Last year, Anaheim flirted with the league's best record, only to be bounced in the playoffs by the Kings. You know how that turned out. This year, the Ducks are at it again. North of the border in Ottawa, slew of goals for the Senators. Mike Hoffman, first of the night off the Anaheim turnover, made it 4-0. The Ducks answered, though, as Ryan Getzlaff made a nifty move to slide the puck past the Senators goaltender. Ducks within two. Hoffman not in any mood to see a Friday night comeback as he puts this one away, beating Ilya Bizgalov. Ducks lose for just the second time in the past 10 games. Rosters from San Diego to L.A. will look very different when spring training begins 2 months from now. Last night, the Dodgers and Padres completed Matt Kemp's swap to San Diego. And today, the Dodgers welcome former Halo Howie Kendrick to the mix. He was a part of a deal last week with Florida. The second baseman will team up with Jimmy Rollins at shortstop. Rollins' move from Philly to L.A. is now official because his deal was part of Kemp going to San Diego. You follow this? Rollins, an Oakland native, says coming to the Dodgers was his top choice. And finally, with hundreds of speeches and appearances on the menu, politicians are known to make a mistake or two. Today, President Obama became the latest example when he confused actor James Franco with a former Super Bowl MVP.
I think it says something interesting about North Korea that they decided to have the state mount an all-out assault on a movie studio because of a satirical movie starring Seth Rogen and James Flacco.
Yeah, that's what you get when you mix James Franco and Baltimore quarterback Joe Flacco. One stars in a movie that is unpopular with North Korean leaders. The other is well remembered for upsetting the Denver Broncos 2 years ago. Flacco took to Twitter to correct the president, but later tweeted to Franco, quote, "Welcome to the family."
He had a rough start in life, from growing up in the foster care system to living in his car, but now he's graduating college. Eyewitness News reporter Greg Lee has the inspiring story of a Long Beach student who continues to overcome obstacles.
I'm not a quitter. You know, it's like I'm going to keep fighting.
Aaron Green knows something about fighting through obstacles. The 23-year-old was born deaf in his left ear and had sickle cell anemia. He was put into foster care when he was just 2 days old. His foster mother died from liver cancer when he was 16.
He always told me that I could do anything I want, I could be anything I want.
Living by those words, he worked his way to Cal State Long Beach. When he couldn't afford to live in the dorms, he studied and slept in his car. His medical condition kept him from his love of playing sports, so he became a manager for the men's basketball team.
I have family here, you know, it might not be by blood, but, you know, it's, you know, by heart, you know, we're all family.
He also found help through the Educational Opportunity Program. The state-funded program helps low-income and first-generation college students find success at school.
And just meeting it and conquering these things, so nothing was ever a deterrent for Aaron.
On Monday, Aaron turned in his last final exam, making him an official college graduate. The sociology major already accepted his diploma in May.
It's not even words that I could describe, you know, how happy I am to finally see this day.
There's still obstacles ahead for Green, like finding a job, a new car, and a place to live. Though it seems like a lot, he's confident everything will work out. He hopes that attitude inspires others to never quit.
We could do it. You know, you just got to first start off with removing I can't with I can.
Greg Lee, ABC 7, Eyewitness News.
A cancer survivor celebrating her fourth year in remission is giving the gift of hope. They're cozy blankets she has collected for current patients. Sarah Scaletta's last radiation session was in November 2010. She had Hodgkin's lymphoma. Now she's helping current cancer patients at Arrowhead Regional Medical Center, where she beat her cancer. She tells patients she understands the pain and suffering of having cancer and getting treatment.
It's definitely a blessing to be able to do this, but I tell them that these are made with love and that I'm giving each and every one of them hope.
It means that there's somebody out there thinking about us, helping us, you know, and it's comforting to know.
So far, Sarah has handed out about 100 of the donated blankets, and she expects 100 more.
More news straight ahead here at 7:30, and ahead tonight on Eyewitness News at 11 on ABC 7. A missing dog discovered wearing a disguise. Tonight we hear from the owner who is reunited with her best friend. Plus, why police are hoping a dating app helps them catch a thief. These stories and all the late breaking news on Southern California's number one late newscast, Eyewitness News at 11 on ABC 7.
Be on the lookout for Dorothy, the Tin Man, and Toto 2 at Union Station soon. Fans of the classic movie, The Wizard of Oz, will be showing up in costume for a free screening tomorrow. Metro will show The Wizard of Oz as part of Union Station's milestone 75th anniversary. It also happens to be the 75th anniversary of the movie. Oz will be screened in the beautiful, huge, historic ticketing hall with a costume contest before. The contest is at 4:30 p.m. and the film begins at 5.
And finally tonight, the makers of a satirical Kim Jong-un video game aren't just going ahead with its release. They say they're now more motivated than ever to finish it. The retro-style game called Glorious Leader puts players in the shoes of a unicorn riding gunslinging Kim, battling things like American drones and even meeting Dennis Rodman. The company Money Horse Games says they now even plan to add a new level to the game set on the Sony Pictures backlot.
Well, we thank you for joining us for Eyewitness News at 7:30 on LA 56. Law and Order SVU is next here on LA 56.
And Eyewitness News continues at 11 p.m. on ABC 7 and anytime on ABC7.com. We will see you tomorrow night here at 7 o'clock right here on LA 56. Have a great weekend.
Good night.